Hi, Kranti.
Hello, good
Yeah,
morning.
good morning. Just some issues with my Zoom. Just it was taking so much time to create the meeting and everything. How are you?
I'm good.
Okay, so yesterday I forgot to send that document. I'll be sending that to you today, okay? That with the questions and everything. Yeah, you have you gone through the sections and everything, what we discussed yesterday?
Yes, I went through the sections. Or did we complete? I don't remember because I was not able to recall this discretionary degree or declaratory degrees.
Declaratory degrees, I think previously it was included, but now it's just from sections 36, I guess. So declaratory degrees, I don't think is a part of your syllabus anymore, or is it? Yeah, because it was from the previous syllabus that many times questions were asked and everything, but now it's not a part of your syllabus anymore.
Okay.
Yeah, and you just asked what is declaratory degree. So I just explained that court will declare something, right? That you are a resident of Karnataka or you are from Maharashtra originally, you are daughter of so and so person. So like that court can declare certain things. Or maybe that you are owner of a certain property, but that is not included in your syllabus. So yeah, don't bother with that. Okay. So rest of the things, is that part clear?
Yes.
Okay, sure then. Fine. So I will share that document as well, and you can start preparing for specific relief. So today we'll start with contract, okay, from the remaining parts, right? For second, whatever we have, from that we will start. Okay. So this is the document for contracts. Okay, again, for contracts, what have you started? Anything you started?
No, ma'am, I didn't start anything.
All right. Okay, so just like Specific Relief Act, right? It's very important that you know the year. And in case, okay, so year is very important that you will anyhow, like have to remember this year that Indian Contract Act is of the year 1872. So in your answer also, right, whenever you are writing Indian Contract Act, you can also write that, okay, fine, Indian Contract Act 1872, right? Like that you can write. So this part is very important that you remember the year. Now, coming to the date of enactment and when it came into force, right? So if you can remember, if it's possible for you, it's well and good, you can remember it. If not, also that's completely fine, all right? Because you don't have objective type questions, they are not going to directly ask when this act was enacted or when it came into force. So if you are not very good at remembering numbers, that's completely fine. You don't need to remember this part. Just try to remember the year because you anyways have subjective type questions, right? So accordingly, you should, like plan whatever you want to keep in mind what all you want to study. Accordingly, you need to prepare depending on the pattern of your syllabus and exam pattern and all of that, right? So you don't need to remember this section if you cannot, but try to remember the year, all right? Okay. So what is the difference between date of enactment and when it came into force? Why do we have two different dates for one single legislation?
Enacted means when it was formed in Parliament and the Parliament said okay and came into force means when it was introduced or accepted by judiciary maybe.
So do we need judiciary's approval or acceptance for any legislation? Don't like Parliament have the absolute authority?
Parliament has the absolute authority, but in case judiciary want to make any changes, judiciary can suggest.
Okay. So what happens is date of enactment, as in finally it's accepted, right? President gave his consent and everything. Finally, it's accepted. That is what we call as enactment date, all right? But when it came into force, as in from what date it becomes applicable, right? If it's applicable in entire India, from what date it became applicable? Because take for example, we have a legislation called Human, you know, like Protection of Human Rights Act 1993, I guess. We can say that fine, this legislation is accepted. Whatever is mentioned under this legislation, it's accepted. President gave his consent, approval, whatever. But now to make this legislation applicable, right, we would need to make certain preparations. We have to establish a national human rights commission, state human rights commissions. We need to appoint members there, chairmen there, right? Otherwise, we cannot just blankly say that, okay, fine, we are, you know, like following this legislation. If we do not have the body, how can we say that we are accepting, right? So that is the reason why we have a certain duration of time to do all the preparations and whatever is needed to be able to follow the legislation, right? Sometimes there might be establishing different bodies, officials, appointing members, chairman, this, that, there may be many things. So basically this time frame is the duration that is given to make all the arrangements that we need, okay? So enactment as in it's accepted that it will become applicable, but not like from 25th of April itself it became applicable. From that date, we knew that, okay, something called as Indian Contract Act will become applicable, but not yet. It will come into force from 1st of September only, and this time frame is given to make all the preparations. This is applicable, like for most of the legislations, you would see different date for enactment, different date for when it came into force. So that is the basic difference. But yeah, it's fine if you don't remember the years also, that is completely fine. It depends on you. Now, moving to what all things are there inside the legislation, right? It's basically divided into two different parts, okay? First part is from sections 1 to 75 that talks about general principles of law of contract. Okay. Now, what are general principles of law of contract?
Which is generally applicable for all the contracts in India.
Yes, which is generally applicable for all the contracts in India, right? It does not matter what is the purpose of our contract or our agreement. Those principles are something that are like basic principles, right? General principles, which will anyways be applicable in any form of or any sort of contract. You are right. So this may be any examples of general principles that you can give?
It should be a registered company for Indian Contract Act. If the company has anything, then it should be registered like that.
Or, you can, yeah. And?
Both the parties should be agreed to enter into the contract.
Okay, and?
There should be a kind of interest, means there should be interest should be in good faith. There must be a reasonable interest to enter into the contract.
Okay. So is it like only companies can enter into contract? Can you and me not enter into a contract under Indian Contract Act?
Yes, we can also enter into the contract.
We can also enter. So these general principles are basically like it will tell who all can make a contract, right? It will tell who are competent to contract, how they will make the contract, how offer will be made, how the other person will accept it. What is consideration, how it will be communicated, how contract should be performed, who will perform, when will perform, where he will perform, right? All that stuff which we need to make a contract and finally, you know, like to fulfill it and everything, right? Whatever is needed to be done with the contract, it tells us every single detail about it. Right? So these are general principles, right? It does not matter what is the purpose of our contract. We will have to fulfill it or we will have to face the consequences, right? So all those things are discussed under sections 1 to 5, which are the general principles, which are generally applicable to any kind of contract that may be there.
Okay.
Next part is sections 124 to 238 that talks about certain specific types of contract. I think specific contracts are not there in your syllabus because you have it as contract part two, I guess. So it tells us about different types of contracts, right? Depending on the purpose for which we are making, contracts are again divided into different types. And out of those, just a few we need to study under Indian Contract Act, like indemnity, guarantee, bailment, agency, pledge, etc., which I think you will be getting in next semester or somewhere like that, where you have contract part two. So now you just have this part, that is general principles of law of contract under sections 1 to 75.
Yes.
Okay? So try to remember this section, that it's 1 to 75 that talks about general principles of law of contract.
Yes.
Okay. And also remember the year 1872.
Yes.
Okay. Now, what is the scope of this legislation? Is it applicable to entire India? Is it applicable to Jammu and Kashmir or not? What is the status?
Okay, it is applicable to Jammu and Kashmir also after the fifth schedule, Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act 2019.
Yes, same, right? Fifth schedule. So whatever I told you for specific relief act, right? Like the introduction, that part you can even copy paste here, that earlier it was not applicable to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, but now it's applicable to union territories of Jammu and Kashmir as well as Ladakh under fifth schedule of Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act of 2019. So that part you can remember, which will be applicable for your IPC also, contracts also, specific relief also, for all the things, right? So like that you should plan your things, right? That whatever is coming under many other things, that part you can, you know, like invest your time in remembering that part, right? So you can accordingly remember this part. It's applicable to whole of India, including Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. Okay, so under the general principles, we have scope and definition. Scope as in where it's applicable. It's applicable to the whole of India. Then we have definitions. So why are definitions important? Take for example, you are studying the Indian Contract Act, where there are different words like contract, agreement, void contract, proposal, offer, acceptance, but you know, like it's not very clear what they want to mean by the term acceptance or by the term offer or by the term consideration or other words, right? So it's very important that they define those words which they are going to be using in the legislation. So accordingly, section one tells us the scope of the legislation, which is it's applicable to entire India, including Jammu and Kashmir and Ladakh. And it provides for definition of certain words under section 2.
Yeah.
Then we have provisions regarding communication, acceptance, and revocation of proposals. Then we have provisions regarding contract, voidable contract, and void agreement. Then we have provisions regarding contingent contract, performance of contract, quasi-contract, consequences of breach of contract, and all that stuff, right? So till this part, you should be knowing from sections 1 to 75, the general principles of law of contract. Okay, now, again, I saw few of your, you know, like previous year question papers for contract as well. And what I have seen is that they are directly asking to define a certain word. Okay, so definitions are important. So definitions are important. Okay, there are not like too many definitions also under the Indian Contract Act. So how many ever you can remember, you can try to remember the definitions. So yesterday I saw a few of the questions. So these are a few of the questions, okay, where they are directly asking you define consideration, define proposal, define offer, define misrepresentation, fraud, and mistake, right? So when it's a question of 6-10 marks, or whatever the amount of marks is, right? And they are asking you directly that define consideration, explain the exception. So in that case, you don't have any other option but to define the word, right? Because they are asking you to define the word. So in that case, it's better if you can remember the definition. So how easy or difficult is it for you to remember the definitions? Considering there are quite a few definitions under the Indian Contract Act, how easy or difficult is it?
Not much. If I understand the definition, what it is in detail, then it is not difficult for me to remember. Just the thing is, I won't be able to write it in exact word, but meaning will be same.
Okay, so that is the thing, okay? When they say define, it should be exact same as what is given there, okay? Because what is definition, right? When they are saying define consideration, you cannot just say consideration is something that I'm getting in return. You cannot just say that. Because that will be explain what is consideration, okay? There is a difference between the two words. Define consideration and explain what is consideration, all right? These two things are different. When they are saying what is consideration, you can explain it in your own words. But when they are saying define consideration, you will have to quote the exact words that are given under the BARE Act. All right. So because it's a little difficult for you to remember the exact words, what you can do is see. I'll just open the BARE Act. Okay, so I'll just open the BARE Act and go to the definitions part. So these are the many definitions which we have till J, okay? 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So we have 10 definitions under Indian Contract Act. Again, few other words are defined in other parts of the legislation as well. So if it's difficult for you to remember the exact wordings, that's completely fine. What you can do is you can try to remember the sections at least. All right. Like section 2 clause A defines proposal. 2 clause B defines, right? So accordingly, you can just remember the, section. So if they are asking define consideration, it's fine if you cannot remember exact wordings for this long definition, but what you can do is section 2 clause D of the Indian Contract Act 1872 defines consideration. Then in your own words also, you can explain it, because it's fine if you don't remember. At least you are remembering the section, right? So it's completely fine. You don't need to waste your time trying to remember the exact words. You can just remember the sections, and in your own words, you can explain the, word that, okay, fine, under Indian Contract Act, this is how it defines, right? It may not be the exact wordings, but somehow it should be close enough, right? And then you can accordingly move ahead with the provision, whatever it is.
Okay. Yes.
All right. So, next thing that we have is regarding definitions, right? So regarding definitions, while studying different things, I will be explaining you the definitions in detail, but this in general is a list of all the definitions which we have. That first is proposal, acceptance or promise, promisor, promisee, consideration, agreement, reciprocal promises, void contract, voidable contract becomes void. So these are the definitions which we have, and other things we will be explaining while discussing different provisions. All right.
Yes.
So there was this story which I created for like judiciary students so that they can remember which section is providing for what definition. In case it's helpful, you can also just try to, see this. All right. So first is what? Proposal, right? First definition that we have is proposal. So take, for example, it's a communication between you and me. All right. And accordingly, you can try to remember the definition. So firstly, take, for example, I asked you, would you like to study Indian Contract Act 1872 from me? If I also provide you important questions, all right, if I also discuss the questions of previous year, like question from previous year question paper, would you like to study Indian Contract Act from me? So what is this sentence? I am giving you a proposal, right?
Yes.
So first is proposal. Accordingly, under Indian Contract Act, Section 2A defines proposal, where I am asking you, if I also discuss important questions or previous year questions, would you like to study Indian Contract Act from me or not? That's the proposal. Right? Next, you said, okay, I don't mind learning from you, but only if you provide MCQs. That is what? Acceptance or promise, right? Acceptance. You agreed.
Yes.
You agreed that you will learn from me, but only if I discuss previous year questions also or important questions also. That means it's like a promise. I made an offer to you. You also agreed that, okay, fine, I will learn from you. That means you made a promise or you accepted my proposal.
Yes.
Right? Accordingly, Section 2B defines what is acceptance or what is promise. Right? If you can remember this story, you will be able to remember all the sections.
Yes. In next line, we can remember.
Yeah, you can remember. Next, I and you agreed, right? When you said that, okay, fine, if you are discussing previous year questions, I'm interested to learn Indian Contract Act from you. That means what? You and I agreed. Who are we?
Yes.
We are promisor and promisee, right? I was the one giving proposal. That means I was the proposer. You are the one who agreed or accepted my proposal. That means you are the promisee. Right? So Section 2C defines promisor and promisee.
No, I'm able to hear.
Okay. So you and I agreed. That means who are you and I? We both are promisor and promisee in this particular contract. So 2C defines who is a promisor and who is a promisee.
Yes.
Next. I want to teach you to get more teaching experience and you want to learn from me to get better understanding of the concepts, right? So why do we want to learn from each other? Because I want to enhance my experience and you want to clarify your concepts, right? So that is what is called as consideration, right? You are getting something out of this contract. I'm also getting something out of this contract.
Yes.
Right? And that something is called as consideration, the main purpose of making the contract, right? We both are getting something in return, that is called as consideration. So Section 2 defines what is consideration.
Yeah.
All right. Next is both of us agreed thinking about the benefits. Agreed means agreement, right?
Agreement.
So it is agreement is defined under Section 2E. Both of us agreed. From agreed, you can remember agreement.
Yes.
We agree thinking about the benefits. Next, discussing previous year questions is something that is also important here. That means it's a reciprocal promise. Reciprocal promise basically is like it's a combination of 2-3 promises, all right? We will explain that later at a later stage also. So you can just remember that. I cannot just explain you the concepts. I will also have to discuss previous year questions, which forms an important part of the contract. So that is a reciprocal promise. Along with teaching the concepts, I will also have to deal with previous year questions and all that stuff, right? So all this stuff is connected. So it's Section 2F, which defines reciprocal promise, where I promise also to discuss previous year questions with you.
Okay.
All right. Next is, if I don't discuss previous year questions, you will not continue with the class. That is what? It will become void. That means I made a promise, right? That I will be explaining or I will be discussing previous year questions. If I don't do that, it will be void. You will not, you know, like you will not attend the classes. That means it becomes void, right? What is void? When the contract is not enforceable, right? If I'm only not discussing previous year questions, I cannot go to court and say that she did not attend my classes, right? Because it becomes void, it will no more be enforceable. So it's Section 2G that defines void. Next is Sec 2H. Only if I am teaching and also discussing previous year questions, I can ask you to attend classes. That means it's a contract, right? I can ask you, right? What is contract? it's enforceable, right? Yeah. I can make you attend my classes when I am discussing previous year questions. So 2H defines contract. Next is, you have the option to leave the class in between if I do not discuss previous year questions. Leave the class in between. You have that option. That means it's voidable. All right. What is voidable? One person will have the option to decide whether he or she wants to continue with the contract or not. That is voidable. So it's section 2I that defines voidable. And lastly, becomes void. It later on, it becomes void. Okay. Void as in it's not applicable or not binding. So contract act itself is removed from your syllabus. All right. They just said that first semester, you don't need to study contract act. That means it becomes void, right? If it's not a part of your syllabus anymore, why would you come and attend my classes, right? So that means it becomes void. Initially, it was applicable. It was part of your syllabus. But at a later stage, it becomes void. It's not applicable anymore.
Yes.
All right. So you can accordingly remember the sections that, okay, this is the sequence. Accordingly, you can remember if they are asking you to define a certain word. No need to waste your time in trying hard to remember the definitions. You can just explain that. Under section 2A, they define proposal. Proposal is briefly this, right? In your own language, also, you can try to explain the concepts. All right. So that is completely fine. So you can accordingly go through this part. And anyways, we are discussing the definitions in detail at a later stage. Okay. Next, another important thing is to know the difference between the terms agreement and contract. So what do you understand by agreement and contract, and how are these two words different from one another?
Agreement is where the both parties agree to enter into a contract, and contract is where the agreement and contract is totally finalized and they enter into a contract.
Okay, so is it like agreement is the initial stage when it's not finalized, or they are in the process of making the contract, or what?
Yes, yes. Agreement, after agreement, the contract is formed.
So all agreements will end up being a contract at some point of time?
Yes.
Okay, no. So this concept is wrong. Okay. First of all, you should understand the difference between contract and agreement. All right. So it's completely fine that this difference is not very clear to you. In fact, I also was not very clear about the difference of contract and agreement in my first semester of LLB. Only after, you know, like clearing contracts and everything, I came to know about it in second semester. So it's completely fine. Okay. So we'll try to understand what is the difference between contract and agreement. All right. So now we'll see the definitions first and then we'll move, okay? First of all, Section 2E of the Indian Contract Act defines the word agreement, all right? What is agreement? Every promise and every set of promises. What is the difference between every promise and set of promises?
Promise is one for one thing we promise, and set of promises means we agree to multiple things.
Yeah, we agree to multiple promises, right? In one single agreement only, there may be multiple promises. Like what I told you, right? I'm teaching contract as well as I'm discussing previous year questions. That means it's a set of promises, right? Yes. Or in another case, I may just tell you that, okay, fine, I'm just providing you notes for contract. That also is a promise. So it can either be one promise or it can be a set of different promises, all right?
Yes.
Forming the consideration for each other is an agreement. Forming the consideration for each other means we both are in such a, you know, like we both are getting something in return. You are also okay making this promise to me. I am also okay making this promise to you. So there is like a consideration between us, and that is agreement. So basically, what is agreement? Any kind of promise or promises where both the parties are okay making that promise, that is only agreement.
Yeah.
All right. If I tell you that from tomorrow onwards, I will go out for a morning walk with you every single day, All right, because I want to lose weight and also I want to lead a healthy lifestyle and stuff. So I will go out with you for morning walk every single day. What happens is it's a kind of promise, right, that we both make. And there is consideration. What is the consideration? You will feel that, okay, fine, if she is coming along, I will also get the motivation to go out every single day. And I also may feel that, okay, fine, I'm getting someone to, you know, like accompany me. I would be motivated to go out every single day. So that also is a consideration. So that will amount to an agreement. We both made a promise where we both are getting something in return and we both agreed on the same thing.
Yes.
All right. It can be one single promise where I told you that I will be going out with you to watch this movie. All right. That also is an agreement. If I accept a dinner invitation, that also is an agreement. All right. So that is what it, basically there has to be a promise and both the parties are having some sort of a mindset that they want to make that contract, right? It may be that I would get someone to have dinner with me. I will get someone to go to the movie theater with someone. It can be anything, all right? So that is basically what is agreement.
Yes.
What is void agreement? An agreement not enforceable by law is said to be void. We know what is an agreement. But when this agreement is not enforceable by law, that is void. It's very important that you consider this thing. Not enforceable by law. All right. That means if I tell you that I will be going out for a movie with you, at a later stage, I say that, no, I'm not going out. If I make a promise, I'm going out for morning walk with you. And at a later stage, I just refuse. You cannot go to court, right?
No.
That means these are not enforceable by law. So whatever promise or promises are not enforceable by law are void. All right. These are void agreements. Is it clear what is agreement? What is void agreement?
Yes.
So not enforceable by law. That means it's a void agreement. You cannot go to court and file a case against me. Yes. Next is section 2H that defines contract. An agreement enforceable by law is contract. If it's enforceable by law, it will be contract. If I am making a promise, I will be teaching you contract along with discussing previous year questions. Later on, I'm not doing it. You can go to court. That means it's a contract. All right. But if I'm telling you I will be going out for a morning walk every single day, I break the promise, you cannot go to court. So that's void agreement.
Yes.
All right. So from these three definitions, we came to know that agreements can either be enforceable by law or not enforceable by law.
Yes.
Okay.
Ma'am,
so
if this also called a void agreement, where, because it is not enforceable by law, if we are doing smuggling or drug dealing, like that kind of things.
So that we will come to that at a later stage also, all right? There are certain agreements where, you know, like the purpose itself is unlawful or the consideration is unlawful. In such cases, the agreement itself will be considered as void. Even though all the other conditions were satisfied, because the purpose was not a lawful purpose, the agreement itself is void. You cannot enforce that also.
Okay.
Yeah, so
that's different thing.
Yeah, that is a different thing and a part of your syllabus. We will discuss that at a later stage.
Okay.
Yeah, so that is included anyways in the syllabus. So agreements are divided into two types. Some are enforceable by law, which are called as contract, like making a promise to, you know, like teach a certain subject. That's a contract. But certain agreements are not enforceable by law, like void agreement, like making a promise to go out for morning walk every single day. All right.
Yeah.
Now here, see, in void agreement, they have clearly mentioned not enforceable by law. That only means that you cannot go to court and file a case, but within your own means, you can still try to enforce the contract. Okay. If I made a promise that I will be going out with you for morning walk every single day, and at a later stage, I just break my promise, you cannot go to court. That's okay. But you can still come to me and try to convince me that why did you refuse this promise? You should have accepted this promise, you should have come because it is, you know, like you will also be in a position to lead a healthy life, this, that. You can try to convince me and maybe I will be convinced and I perform my promise. Okay. So it's not like you cannot just enforce it. It only means that you cannot enforce it by law. You cannot take help of law, but within your own means, you can still try to convince me. You can still try to manipulate me and all that stuff.
Okay.
Okay. So take, for example, there is a mother. Okay. Mother tells her son that, okay, after he comes back from school, right? Mother just tells that, you finish your homework and only after that you can go out to play. All right. Son also says that, okay, okay, I'm completing my homework. Then only I will step out. All right. So the moment mother, you know, like goes to the other room, he just goes out to play. Okay. So can mother go to the court and file a case saying that my son just broke this promise that he had made? He did not complete his homework. He did not finish his homework. Can she go to court? No. But what mother can do is that she can still go to park, bring him back and make him complete his homework, right?
Yes.
So it cannot be enforced by law, but mother is having her own abilities to make the son perform his contract, whatever promise he made, right? So that is what the difference is.
Okay.
All right. It's not enforceable by law, but within our own means, we can still try to convince the other person to perform it. All right. So agreements are divided into two types. Some are enforceable by law, which are called as contract. Some are not enforceable by law, which are called as void agreements.
Void agreement. Yes.
Okay. So these are the basic differences between contract and agreement. And it's very important. I have seen questions where they are asking, what is the difference between contract and agreement? Are all contracts agreement and similar sort of questions I have seen. So try to remember the differences. What is agreement? Offer plus its acceptance is agreement. You come to me and ask me, would you like to go out for morning walk every single day with me? I accept that becomes an agreement. But in case of contract, agreement, that means offer plus acceptance, plus it has to be legally enforceable. Only then it becomes a contract. You should be in a position to go to court for violation. Only then it becomes a contract. Is it clear?
Yes.
Next is every agreement may not be contract. So agreement basically is a broader word. All right. Agreement is a broader word. Okay. Because what is agreement? Just an offer plus its acceptance, that is agreement. So agreement is a broader word and any kind of promises would come under it. But contract is just a small portion of agreements. Only some of these promises are enforceable in court of law, right? So you just try to remember this diagram that agreement is a broader word, under that contract is falling. That means all agreements may not be contract, but all contracts are agreements. Is that clear?
Yes.
So this now, question, I think 5 times this question was asked. Okay, all contracts are agreements, but not all agreements are contracts. Explain. Like that, this question came. So try to remember this diagram. Agreement is a broader word that involves offer plus acceptance. But contract is just a small portion. So contract is those promises which can be enforceable by law.
Yes.
All right. So try to remember this chart and you will remember this sentence as well. So every agreements may not be contract. Some of these are not enforceable. But in case of contract, all contracts are agreement because contract is falling under this circle of agreement, right?
Yes.
An agreement may not create legal obligation, right? If I'm making a promise to go out with you for morning walk, that is not creating any kind of legal obligation on me. But in case of contract, it will necessarily create a legal obligation, right? I will be legally bound and answerable if I'm violating a contract.
Yes.
All right. It's clear, right? 3 points.
Yes. It's clear.
agreement
how do
is
summarize
yeah. how do you
summarize this statement about agreements and contracts?
Okay, like this statement?
Huh?
This statement, is it?
Yes, yes.
Okay, I'm coming to that. So fourth point, I'll just explain. Agreement yes. is not a concluded and binding contract in all cases. In all cases, it's not like it's binding on us, we are legally answerable, but in case of contract, it's always binding on us and we will have to answer back if we are violating. So in case there is a question like all contracts are agreements, but not all agreements are contracts. So again, you can start with a basic introduction, just like Specific Relief Act, right? Mentioning its applicability, this, that, and whatever you remember. And then you can start with defining what is contract, what is agreement, and then telling the differences between the two. And then you can say that agreement is a broader word, this, that comes under it, but contract is only a small part of it. Only some of these would be enforceable in the court of law. But again, it does not mean parties do not have any other option. Within their own means, they can still try to enforce it. But it just means that they cannot take help of law. And accordingly, you can explain, right? Whatever you know regarding agreement and contract, you can frame the answer accordingly, depending on the marks, right?
Okay. Yeah.
And also in the later classes, you will know in detail about contracts, in detail about agreements, right? So from there also, you can take inputs and frame your answer. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so try to remember this chart. That will be a lot of help for you. Now, this is another thing. So for, now we know what is an offer or a proposal, right? I am making an offer to you or a proposal to you. All right. So what happens when an offer is made? Okay. I am making an offer to you that I want to teach you contracts. Are you interested or not? In that case, you have two options, all right? What are these two options? You can either reject the offer. You can say that, no, I don't need any help with contracts. I can manage it myself, right? So you are, in clear words, rejecting my offer. In that case, what will happen is there will be no contract, right? If you are straight away rejecting my offer, obviously there will be no contract. Right?
Yeah.
But you also have the option of accepting my offer.
Hmm.
All right. So how you can accept my offer? If I'm saying that I will be teaching you contracts and I will be finishing that within 3 months. All right.
Hmm.
So what you are saying is, so this was my offer, right? I will be finishing contracts within 3 months and I can help you with contracts. What you said is that you have again two options. You can either say that, okay, fine. I will learn contracts from you in 3 months. That means what? You are accepting my offer unconditionally, right? Without putting any conditions, without any other things, you have accepted it as a whole. I told you I will be teaching contracts. You accepted that. I told you I will be finishing it in, you know, like 3 months. You accepted that. That means without putting any other conditions, you just accepted my offer. All right. So when it is accepted unconditionally, it will lead to formation of a contract.
Okay.
Right? But you can also put certain conditions to it. When I'm saying I will finish it within 3 months, you are putting another condition to it and you said that, no, my exams are nearing. I don't have 3 months time. So you try to finish it within 5 days. All right. So what you are doing is, rather than accepting my offer, you are putting your own conditions to it.
Yes.
Right. You are saying that I want you to finish it within 5 days. That means that's a condition which you are putting. So that does not mean you are accepting my offer. Right. You are not accepting my offer. But what you are doing is you are making a counter offer to me. Right, I gave you an offer, but rather than accepting or rejecting this offer, what you are doing is you are giving me a counter offer. Right, you are giving me one offer in return with your own conditions and stuff. All right.
Okay.
So in that case, what happens is when you do that, when you give me a counter offer, I become, you know, like our positions would change. It's as if like you are giving me an offer, right? So I will again have two options to accept it or to reject it. All right. If I am rejecting your offer, if I'm saying that 5 days is too less to finish the entire, you know, like course, I cannot do that. So that means there will again be no contracts. But if I'm saying that, okay, fine, I can finish it within 5 days, that means there will be a contract.
Yes.
All right. Is this part clear? So when an offer is made, you will have two options to accept or reject it. If you are rejecting, for sure, it will not lead to any contract. If you are accepting, you can either accept it completely without any conditions, which will lead to formation of a contract. But if you are putting your own conditions, it will be a counter offer, and I will have the option of accepting or rejecting. And depending on what I have done, it will either lead to formation of a contract or no contract between us. All right.
Ma'am, what is difference between offer and proposal?
What is difference between offer and proposal? It's same thing only. Offer and proposal. Yeah, same thing only. When you are giving me a proposal and when you are giving me an offer, it's the same stuff. It's not different. Yeah.
Okay.
So there was a question regarding define counter offer. Like, what is counter offer? Write a short note on counter offer. Okay. So in that case, you can explain that. Okay, fine. This is what offer is. One person is making an offer. At that time, the person will have two options to accept or reject. But rather than accepting the offer completely, he is putting his or her own conditions and giving a counter, you know, like another offer, like a new offer. That is what counter offer is. If counter offer is given, our positions would change. If I was the offerer, you were the offeree, you will become offerer, I will become offeree. I will have options of accepting or rejecting, like that in your own words, you can explain if a question comes at all.
Okay,
is that part clear? What is offer? What is counter offer?
Yes.
So anyways, if you go through this chart, it will be clear. Okay, there are some like MCQs. This again is for judicial, it's of no use for you. So we'll move to another slide. Okay. Elements of contract. Now, we know what is a contract, right? Section 2H that defines what contract is. It's any sort of agreement which is enforceable by law, right? Agreements that are enforceable by law are contracts. Now, for formation of a valid contract, what happens? There are certain basic elements. Certain conditions has to be satisfied or fulfilled. Only then it becomes a valid contract. Okay, so these are called as basic elements of contract. So I guess there was a question on this as well, like explain the basic elements of contract. So accordingly, you can write that. And also from inside, also questions were there, like what is offer and acceptance, what is free consent and all of that. So accordingly, you can, frame the answer. Okay, so in case there is a question, okay, what happens? Take, for example, there is a question regarding this thing, right? That all agreements may not be contract, but all contracts are agreements. You can even put the diagram thing also. It just, you know, like shows that you know the concept really well, okay? You can even, you know, like put the diagram also. If they are asking regarding basic elements of contract, you can make a diagram of your own, right? You can just mention basic elements, then you can put the, like this, you can write all the elements, right? It just reflects that, okay, fine, these are the things that you are writing inside your answer sheet. So accordingly, you can do that also. Okay, so now, basic elements of a contract. These are the basic elements, 5 basic elements that we will be discussing. First one is offer plus acceptance. First one is offer or proposal. Okay, just now you asked, right, what is the difference? So these are the two same words only. It's section 2A that defines what is offer or proposal. So what is offer or proposal? When one person signifies to another his willingness to do or to abstain from doing anything with a view to obtaining the assent of that other to such act or abstinence, he is said to make a proposal. So what is offer or proposal? It's defined under section 2A of the Indian Contract Act, and it says when one person signifies. What is signifies? Letting the other person know. Okay, so when one person lets the other one know, okay, if I am making a proposal or offer to you, I will let you know.
Yeah.
Okay, what I will let you know? My willingness to do or to abstain from doing anything. That means I am interested in doing something, or I'm interested not to do something. All right, I am interested in teaching Indian Contract Act to you, or maybe I am interested not to teach this subject to anyone else during this period of 5 days. All right, that also may be an abstinence. So I am letting you know about my willingness, about my interest to do something or not to do something for you. All right, now why am I letting you know that? Why am I letting you know about my intentions? With a view to obtaining the assent. Assent as in consent, right? I want to obtain your consent to such act or abstinence. I want to take your approval or your acceptance with regard to that. That you also are willing to, you are also willing to learn Contract Act from me, right? So I want to obtain your approval, and that is the reason why I am letting you know about my intention. So that is what offer or a proposal is.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Yes.
So you can just remember one simple thing, and that same example can be applied in all the different, you know, like concepts which we have, right? So you can just remember, I am asking you that I want to teach Indian Contract Act. Are you interested to learn or not? Why am I doing so? Because obviously I would need your approval, right? I cannot just log in on Zoom and start teaching. You also should be present there, right? So that is the reason why I need your approval. That is the reason why am I asking you or giving you the proposal. So that will be a proposal or an offer. Okay, is that clear?
Yes, please.
Yeah. So take, for example, in previous 2 days, we were taking class from like 6 to 8, right? So today, yesterday I asked you, are you free from 11 to 1? Why did I ask you? That is a proposal, right? Why did I ask you? Because I cannot simply come log in on Zoom and then start teaching. You also should be present, right? So I wanted to take your approval that you are also available from 11 to 1 to attend the class. Right? So that is a proposal, right? As simple as that. Now, an offer involves few of the essential elements, okay? So what are the things that an offer involves? An offer involves these three things, okay? Expression of readiness. What is expression of readiness? When I am making the offer to you, right? It should reflect that if you give your acceptance to it, I am ready to perform it. All right. So what is expression of readiness? Take, for example, yesterday I asked you, are you free from 11 to 1 to take a class? All right. And you also agreed that, okay, fine, I am available. Right. When you said you are available at that point of time, I cannot say that, no, I am not available at that time to take the class. Or will I say that? I will not say like that. Right. Why? Because I was already ready to take the class from 11 to 1, and with that intention only I asked you. So when you accept my offer at that point of time, I will not say that, oh, but not, I'm not available. I will not say it, right? So an offer will include expression of readiness. That means if you are accepting my offer, I am ready to perform it. If you are free from 11 to 1, I'm ready to take the class at that point of time only.
Okay.
right? It is as simple as that. It involves expression of readiness, right? If someone is, take for example, someone is giving another person a marriage proposal, right? That also is a proposal or offer, right? Someone is giving a marriage proposal to another person, like, will you marry me? The other person says that, okay, fine, I can marry you. And then he says that, oh, but I'm not, you know, like mentally prepared to get married at this age. It will look like very stupid, right? So that is what it is, that it should reflect expression of readiness. If the other person is saying yes, he should be ready to accept it, right? As simple as that. It involves expression of readiness. It is made to another person. So offer should be made to another person, right? I cannot make an offer to myself saying that, all right, I will wake up at 4 o'clock every single day and will start studying from 4 o'clock, and then I'm breaking the promise and then I'm going to court that she, you know, like I agreed to my offer and then I violated my offer. So court will feel like I'm a mad person, right? So offer has to be made to another person only. Like technically we may make an offer to ourselves. We may say that if I am getting you know, like 80% in this exam, I will gift myself a mobile phone. I can still do that, but I cannot go to court saying that I secured 80%, but even then I did not gift myself a mobile phone. That will look stupid, right? So it has to be made to another person.
Yes.
And lastly, to obtain assent, why will I make the offer to you? Why will I let you know what I think, what I feel, what I want? Only because I want to get acceptance or approval from you, right? If I am willing to take a class from 11 to 1, I want your approval on the same. And that is the reason why I'm coming to you and telling you or giving you the offer or proposal. Okay. So you can remember this simple day-to-day examples, and from that only you can remember the elements also. It has to reflect expression of readiness. You can simply remember like one person giving marriage proposal to the other and the other one accepts, and then he would be like, no, I'm not ready to get married right now. So that should not be the case. It has to reflect expression of readiness. It should be made to another person. I cannot say that, will you marry me? I cannot marry myself, right? So it has to be made to another person. To obtain assent, if I want to marry someone, I cannot just go and marry the person. The other person has to agree as well, right? So it must be to obtain assent of the other. So you can remember this example and remember all these three essential elements of like a valid offer or proposal, all right?
Yes.
So next is, an offer may be made to whom offer, like how we will make the offer. It may be made expressly or it may be made impliedly. So what is the difference between express and implied?
Express is in written form and implied is in word form. Like we do communication and we do it. Just through communication, like verbal and non-verbal, that kind of difference.
Okay, so it's not like written and verbal. It's basically express, as in expressly I'm telling you. Maybe I'm writing you an email, writing a letter, writing you know, like an SMS or anything. Or it may be expressly I'm telling you. Okay, clearly I'm telling you. That will also come under express, right? I am asking you, are you interested to learn contract from me? That is express. I'm clearly asking you, are you interested or not interested? Right? That is express. But what is implied? Proposal is made otherwise than in words, not in clear words, but otherwise. Take for example, my actions or my behavior is giving the, you know, like indication that I'm interested in making a proposal. Take for example, I'm going to like a, you know, like a sabji mandi, and I just picked up some onions. Okay. I just measured the weight. It was 1 kg, and I just, you know, like gave money to the shopkeeper and I took the onion. That means there was no communication between us, right? I did not tell him anything. He did not ask me anything, but still there was an offer, right? The moment I picked up the onions, that means I'm interested in buying those onions from him.
Yes.
Right. So that is an implied offer. I did not tell him directly that, okay, fine, give me 1 kg of honey and I'll pay you this much amount. That nothing was there. But it was implied from my actions or from my behavior.
Yes.
Right. Take, for example, you just got down from a train and you were standing there with your luggage and stuff. A coolie comes, he just picks up your luggage and he starts walking. All right, to the taxi stand. And you are also not restricting him. You are also walking, you are also following him. That means what? There was an implied offer made by the coolie that I'm picking up your luggage and you will have to pay for my service. And because you were also following him and you did not restrict him, that means you have also accepted to pay him for the service, right? That is what is implied offer.
Okay.
So express is clearly you are saying that this is what I want to do. Do you want to accept it or not? Implied is from our actions, behavior, and other things. It is very clear that I'm interested to enter into a contract. Okay, if a public bus is there, okay, the bus was going to this other bus stop and I just, got up. So what happens in that case? I'm not telling the driver that, okay, fine, please drop me in this, bus stand. I will be paying you the fare, this, that. I'm not doing that. It indicates, right? My actions or my behavior indicates that I'm interested to, pay for the bus fare. And I also have money to make the payment, right? So that is what implied offer is. I'm not directly telling anything, but still my actions, my behavior clearly indicates that I'm interested to or I'm making this particular offer, right? So it can be made expressly or impliedly.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, to whom offer will be made? I am interested in making a contract, but to whom I will make the offer? Right? So depending on to whom offer is made, it is divided into two different types, specific offer and general offer.
Yeah.
All right. This is very important. This question again was asked multiple times, all right? So depending on to whom offer is made, it can be of two different types, specific offer and general offer, all right? What is specific and general offer? Any idea?
Yes. Specific offer is that I specifically put an offer to you to come and contract with me. But general offer is that I generally to everyone, I publish in the newspaper, it is general offer like that.
Okay, right. So in case of specific offer, you are specifically making it to one person, group of persons, organization, group of organizations and things like that. And those specific person or persons only will have a right to accept your offer. But in case of general offer, it's open for the public. Whoever is interested can come forward, accept your offer and proceed with it, right? So that is the basic difference. Okay, so again, there is this important case which was also asked in your paper that, write a short note on this case, Carlyle versus Carbolic Smokeball Company. So try to remember this case. It's the very famous case of contract, okay? This is the first case that you will learn in contracts, okay? It's that important. If you know only one case of Indian contract act, that will be this case. It's that important. So you can remember this. This case is relating to general offer. All right. Carlyle versus Carbolic Smokeball Company related to general offer. So if there is a question relating to general offer, or regarding this case, you can always mention this case. Or if there is a question regarding define offer or explain offer, there also you can mention that offer can be divided into two types, specific and general. Then you can explain this case as well there also. Okay, wherever it fits, you can write it. Now, this was the time of 1889 to 1890, where what happened? A deadly flu pandemic. This flu, Asiatic flu that was there, and it killed about 1 million people worldwide, right? So this was a situation similar to what is happening currently, right? The COVID situation, right? All all of us are worried about the situation, right? You can just imagine about last year when vaccination was not there and all that thing, right? People were worried, right? Whatever medicine would come, people would just trust and go take it, right? Just how it happened with Patanjali, right? Coronil, they just declared that it will cure corona. People started buying it, but then restrictions were put, right? So you can imagine like a similar situation where this flu pandemic killed about 1 million people worldwide. So obviously people were, you know, like worried about it. And at that point of time, just like how Patanjali did last year, there was one medical firm, all right? They did what? The Carbolic Smoke Ball Company. So it was a medical firm named Carbolic Smoke Ball Company, and they published an ad on the newspaper. All right, so they published an ad on the newspaper. What you will see generally, right? Newspaper will have different ads. They also published in one ad, and they wrote that we have discovered a medicine or a cure for this deadly pandemic flu, and we have named it as Smoke Ball. Okay, we have named this medicine as Smoke Ball, and we also assure you that if you are taking this medicine based on the directions given by us, you will not suffer from influenza or other similar diseases. Okay, so in the ad, they also mentioned that in case, even after taking the medicines based on our guidelines, even in that case, if you suffer from influenza or any similar diseases, we will be giving you a reward of 100 euros. All right, we will be giving you this reward in case you suffer from influenza. And just to obtain your trust, we have also deposited 1,000 euros in Alliance Bank. All right, so they basically said that we will give you this reward, and we have already deposited the amount. So it's not like we will not have money at that point of time to reward you. We have already deposited the amount. So for sure, we will be rewarding you in case you suffer from influenza. And in that particular ad, what they did is they clearly wrote that this is how you should consume it, all right? They basically gave all the instructions that for some 3 weeks, I guess, you will have to take twice daily, whatever, right? They gave clear instructions and accordingly, you had to basically take that medicine. Now, what the smoke ball was basically, it was like a ball, all right, with a tube attached to the ball. Okay, and inside the ball, they will fill some medicines, okay? Some medicines will be filled inside the ball, and it will have like a tube. So the user will have to insert it inside his nose and press that ball, all right? So whatever medicine is there, it will go inside his nose, and basically it will cure influenza and will protect him from influenza. Okay, so this ad was published, and there was a lady called Carlyle. She came across this ad and she was really impressed with it. And she went forward, she bought smoke balls and started consuming it based on whatever directions were given by the company, right? Whatever number of doses this that was given, she accordingly started consuming it. And with each pack, right, with each of those smoke balls, they also attached one instruction booklet, right? How you should take it. She followed everything and she started taking it. But after the duration was over, right, for whatever number of weeks they mentioned you should be taking it, after that duration was over, she suffered from influenza, all right? So her husband wrote a letter to the company saying that my wife was taking your medicine, this smoke ball, and after that also she suffered from influenza. So as promised by you, you should be paying us a reward of 100 euros. But the company wasn't replying. 2-3 times he wrote, company wasn't replying. Lastly, he filed a case. At that time, company said that no, even though we meant that we will be paying 100 euros, that was just to attract customers. We were not serious about it. All right. We were not serious about it. And also, we did not ask your wife to take the medicine. Right. So we did not even give her an offer. So how come she accepted the offer? Even though she accepted, she did not communicate that with us, right? We don't have any way of knowing whether she actually consumed our medicine or not, and whether she consumed it based on the given direction or not. So we are not responsible to pay you any amount of money. You are not eligible, basically.
Uh-huh.
Right? But court, what court held is that when you are publishing the ad, you clearly said that you have already deposited 1,000 euros in bank. That clearly indicates that it was not something that you casually said, right? You were serious mm-hmm. about the promise or the offer that you were making. So you cannot now yeah. just say that you did not mean it. You definitely meant it. Mm-hmm. And in the yeah. ad, you clearly mentioned that this is how medicine should be taken. You never mentioned nothing. You mentioned that the person should tell you, person should inform you or anything like that. Whatever you mentioned in the ad, she followed everything. That means that amounts to a valid offer and acceptance. Now you cannot just refuse that you are not liable. You are for sure liable to make the compensation, to make the, you know, like pay the reward. Accordingly, the company was asked to pay the reward. So this case, right, is relating to general offer, that when a general offer is made, it's not necessary that you go to them, tell them that I'm accepting your offer. You can just fulfill the terms and conditions and that will amount to giving acceptance. Okay, take for example, if you are going to a shopping mall, okay, and they are saying that, okay, fine, this Durga Puja offer is going on. If you buy for 5,000 rupees, you will get, you know, like an iron free, you will get a mixer grinder free, this, that. In that case, when you are going to the shopping mall, you don't go to the manager and say that, okay, fine, I'm interested to buy for 5,000 rupees and I give my consent, so you give me this reward. You don't do that, right? You just go to the shopping mall, you pick up stuff. If it's 5,000 rupees, you are entitled to it, right? So that basically what general offer is, that you don't go to them and tell them that I'm interested, I'm accepting. No. You just fulfill the terms and conditions. What are these terms and conditions? You shop for 5,000, you shop for 3,000 or whatever the amount is, right? So you, by fulfilling the terms and conditions also, you can give acceptance to a general offer, and same thing happened in this case.
Okay.
Is it clear, the case and the differences?
Yes.
So you can try to remember this case, okay? Carlyle versus Carbolic Smokeball Company. And just like a story, you can remember. It's very important.
Yeah.
Okay, next, another case is there, which also you can consider for general offer. It's also very landmark and very famous case. Lalman Shukla versus Gauri Dutt. All right, this case is relating to general offer. Now, what happened in this case is there was basically one person called Gauri Dutt. All right. What happened is that one day his nephew went missing. Okay. He was not able to find his nephew and he was having a servant called Lalman. So he just told his servant that my nephew is missing. So you go and look for him. All right. You go and find my nephew. And the moment Lalman left, right, the servant left from there, the owner, Gauri Dutt, he announced a reward. He announced a reward that I will be paying 501 rupees to anyone who will be able to find my missing nephew.
Okay.
Right? So after this announcement was done and everything was done, and by the time Lalman already went, right? The servant already went looking for the nephew. So somewhere he found the nephew, he brought him back and everything. Okay. He was not having any knowledge about the offer, right? That he was agreeing to pay 501 rupees because he already left the place. So at a later stage, he came to know about the reward and he decided to claim it. He just said that because I already, you know, like I gave you information about your missing nephew, so I'm entitled to get the amount or reward. But in this case, the servant was not rewarded. Why? Because it's very important. So this is the main gist of this case. Okay. Knowledge of offer is needed before fulfilling terms and conditions of offer. Yes.
Okay.
For general offer, you don't need to give your acceptance. You don't need to go to the person and say that I'm doing this, I'm accepting and other things. But you should have knowledge of the offer. You should know that there is an offer like this. And after having this knowledge only, you should be fulfilling the terms and conditions. All right, in that case only you are entitled. So in this case, solvent was not having knowledge about the offer also. He just gave information about the missing nephew as a duty, as an obligation, right? Because he is a servant of the person. He has to follow whatever directions are being given. He had no knowledge of the offer when he was giving information about the missing nephew. That means without having knowledge, he fulfilled the terms and conditions. So that will not be considered as giving acceptance. Is it clear?
Yes, yes.
So you can just remember this part, that knowledge of offer is very much needed before fulfilling terms and conditions of offer. It cannot be just that just by luck you were doing whatever were the terms and conditions and you can claim for it. It's not like that. So next is difference between offer and invitation to offer. Now we know that what is an offer. What is invitation to offer then? How are these two words different?
Can't see properly.
Offer and invitation to offer difference? Not clear, right?
Yes, not clear.
Okay. So we know what offer is, right? That I'm making an offer to you just to obtain your approval. Now, what is invitation to offer? And we know, right, in case of offer, we need readiness, right? Expression of readiness. If you are agreeing to it, I cannot just say that I'm not interested, I'm not ready or stuff. But in case of invitation or invitation to offer, it can happen. So basically, offer and invitation to offer are two different words. Okay, they are different from one another. And it's again very important for exam point of view. Okay, so what is offer plus invitation to offer? Offer is I am ready and willing to do whatever I am saying. I am just waiting for your approval. But invitation to offer is what? I am inviting other people. I'm inviting you or other people like you to come forward and give me offers. Then I will decide whether I want to accept it or not. One simple example I will give you. Take for example, there is an ad published on the newspaper where they are saying that we have a 2 BHK house vacant. Okay, we are looking for tenants to stay in this house. All right, and the rent is 18,000. Okay, but this does not mean that any person who would go there and claim that I want to stay here, I am able to pay 18,000 rupees per month. It does not make the owner bound to give, you know, like allow that person to leave as a tenant. Right? Owner may have certain other conditions or qualifications. Maybe owner is looking for a family with no kids, or maybe owner is looking for a person who is from that particular area only, or other things, right? Other things might be there, right? Other conditions. So that is what is invitation to offer. That means owner has published an ad on the newspaper that he is having a 2 BHK house vacant. Rent for the same is 18,000. But that does not mean that any person who is able to pay 18,000 rupees per month can just go and demand that I will stay there. Owner may have certain other conditions. Maybe I'm going there and asking him whether I can stay there or not. Maybe owner did not like me and he just said that, no, I'm not giving this house to you. Right? Owner can say that. Why? Because he was just inviting other people to come and give him an offer. He did not give me an offer that you come and stay at my place. Right? So that is the basic difference between offer and invitation to offer. Okay, so invitation to offer and general offer are also different, right? Offer is offer. I am ready to do if you accept. But invitation to offer is you come, you give me offers, I will decide whether I want or not. Right? If take for example, I am publishing, if there is an ad, all right, published that so-and-so company has a vacancy, all right? Take, for example, your college, all right? KLE has a vacancy for law teachers, all right? We want a faculty for law, okay? There is an ad published on the newspaper. They have also mentioned that we want someone who has completed LLM and we prefer a person who has 1 month of teaching experience, all right? They have mentioned everything clearly. I go there and I say that, all right, I have completed LLM. I also have 1 month of teaching experience. So you give this job to me. Is KLE bound to give me the job?
No, they will choose.
Yeah, they will choose, right? They are not bound to provide, even though they mentioned that this is the qualification, this is what we are looking for. They are not bound that they should give the job to me. Maybe there are 10 people, they did not like any of those 10 people. They can just refuse that we are not hiring any of you. Why? Because it was just an invitation to offer, right? They invited us that you come, you show your experience, you show your knowledge, then we will decide whether we want to hire you or not. That is what invitation to offer is.
Okay.
Right? But in case, take for example, a person went there, attended the interview, they liked him, they said that, okay, fine, we are hiring you. And from 1st of April, you will have to join. That is an offer. Right. So the person can say that, okay, fine, I'm also joining, or maybe I'm not available from 1st of April or whatever the case is. So that is the basic difference between offer and invitation to offer.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Yes. Offer is basically open offer, and invitation to offer is that you may get many options and you are the one who can choose.
Yeah. Yeah, basically, I have not yet decided. You come, you give me offer, I will see whether I like it or not. In case of offer, I'm already interested and ready to do it. Okay. Yeah. And now, take for example, you know, like you are going to a bakery shop and they have displayed one cake, like a princess cake, all right? And you want to buy that cake. You just say that I want this cake now itself, pack it, give it to me. What is it? Is that offer or invitation to offer that they are displaying a princess cake in the counter?
They are displaying this invitation to offer.
It is invitation to offer, right? Why? Because maybe, right, the bakery shop will not just make a princess cake. Maybe it was an order that was placed by someone, right? So if I go and say that now itself I want to buy this cake, the pastry shop owner may refuse. They may say that, no, we made this because someone had placed a pre-order and we are selling it to that person only. If you want a similar cake, you place an order, tomorrow you take it. Right? So that was an invitation to offer. Even though they displayed it there, we cannot say that you give that to me, you sell it to me. Right? Same thing may happen if you are going to a shop, right? They have displayed some dress, beautiful dress, gown, this, that. You cannot just say that I want to buy this gown. Maybe someone has placed an order for that gown. Because of that only they made this gown. So they may not sell that to you. They may say that it was custom, you know, like customized for a certain client. You place an order, we will make it for you. So that is the difference between offer and invitation to offer.
Yes. And what is that first come, first serve comes into?
Which one?
If there is something like first come, first serve, what is that? Does that come into an offer?
Again, it depends. Take for example, there is someone is, you know, like someone has opened a course and they said that it's like only 100 seats we have. It will be on first come, first serve basis. So if anyone can join the course, that will be an offer. You just go fill the registration form, pay the fees, you are a part of that course. So that will be an offer. But again, it may be first come, first serve basis, as in take for example, someone has published an ad that it's like an open interview. Anyone can come, okay, a walk-in interview. Anyone can come, attend the interview. There also they can say that, okay, whoever is coming first, that person will go first inside the you know, like with the interviewer, he will be interviewed first. That again, you cannot say that is an offer. Yeah. So first come, first serve is just a condition on how people would be treated or how you will get the opportunity. That is a different thing, little bit different thing.
Okay.
Yeah. So next, there is one case relating to invitation to offer. All right. So this case is what happened basically. It is Harris versus Nickerson relating to invitation to offer. In this case, there was one person, okay, they published an ad on the newspaper. It was London newspapers. They published an ad that we are conducting an auction for 3 days. All right, for 3 days, we will be conducting an auction where we will be selling different items like brewing equipments, plant and other office furniture. So there will be basically three categories of you know, like goods or items that we will be selling in this auction. And on the third day, we will be selling office furniture. Basically, this auction was divided in 3 days. On the third day, we will be selling office furniture. Now, there was one person who was like a broker, okay? He will basically take commission from his clients. He will go attend those auctions on behalf of his clients and buy things from there on behalf of the client. So what he did is that based on that auction, he took commission from a client and he said that I will be attending the auction on the third day and buy office furniture for you. All right. He just made the agreement and everything and he went to that place. So basically he was residing here and auction was there at some far place. Okay. Some far away place. So he had to travel all the way to that place to attend the auction and everything.
Yeah,
but on the third day when he reached there, he already took commission from his client and everything. He went there. That time he found out that the auction got cancelled. Basically, first and second day it took place. On the third day it got cancelled because of some reason. So he filed a case saying that I had to travel all the way to attend this auction. I already took commission from my client and now because this auction got cancelled, I had to suffer loss. So this company will have to pay me compensation. All right. So in this case, it was said that the auctioneer did not give you an offer. It was merely an invitation to offer. You were invited to bid there, attend the auction. And if you are your bidding is highest, you will get to buy the product. It was not an offer, but an invitation to offer. So they are not liable to pay you, you know, like the amount that you had to spend to travel to that particular place. So that was an invitation to offer. So this case is relating to invitation to offer that you can remember Harris versus Nickerson.
Yes.
So clear this part, right? Offer, invitation and all that thing.
Yes.
Okay, there is one more case relating to invitation to offer. It is Pharmaceutical Society of Great Britain versus Boots Cash Chemist Limited. This is also relating to invitation to offer.
Okay.
So in this case, what happened? There was a shop of drugs, all right? So they were having different drugs that they were selling. And in that shop, what you had to do basically, just like what you will see, right? Usually in any shopping mall or any supermarket, you will pick up a basket from, you know, like near the entrance. You will pick up a basket. You will go inside whatever items you want. You will just pick that, put inside the basket. You will go to cash counter, pay for it and leave, right? So same thing happened here also that they were dealing with drugs and different drugs were displayed on the counters, all right? So customer will have to pick up a, you know, like a basket. They can just pick whatever drugs they need, go to cash counter, pay for it and leave. Same thing happened in this case and the plaintiff selected drugs and when he bought the drugs in front of the cash counter, the man or the pharmacist who was there at the cash counter, he said that we are not selling these days drugs. All right. Few of the drugs, they just refused that we are not selling these days drugs. Now, the question is whether the displaying of goods with a price tag on them is an offer to sell or just an invitation to offer. All right. Because in the drugs, they also mentioned the price, right? With price tag attached, if a certain thing is displayed, whether it's an offer or an invitation to offer. Court held that it was an invitation to offer only. The property in the thing would not pass in favor of buyer unless his offer is accepted, right? So even the price tag is there, it does not amount to offer, but it only amounts to invitation to offer. And if you want to buy it, it depends on the shopkeeper whether he is interested to sell it to you or not.
Okay.
All right. So same thing. Maybe you are going to a shop. They have displayed a beautiful gown with a price tag attached. And okay, fine. This is for 20,000 rupees. That does not mean that you can just claim for it. They can say that, yes, price is 20,000 rupees, no doubt. But this gown is made for a customer. You can pay 20,000 rupees, we will make another one for you, but not this one. We cannot sell this one. Same happened in this case also, right? Pharmaceutical Society of Great Britain versus Boots Cash Chemist Limited.
Okay.
So whatever cases I'm discussing, right, these are like very landmark cases, okay? Not like any random case I'm discussing, very landmark cases. So if you can remember, you can remember this cases, maybe if they are asking that, okay, discuss this case, right, directly they can give any of these cases also. These are that important. All right. And one more thing I want to tell you, how good are you at remembering these names? Because when you are writing a case, right, you will have to mention the exact same thing. If it's Harris versus Nickerson, you will have to write Harris versus Nickerson. So how good are you at remembering that?
Average, not good so much. Like perfectly, I can't remember.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay. So see, again, there are few cases which are very, very important. For that, you can try to remember. Okay, like Harris versus Nickerson. It's not that difficult, right? Two words. Mm-hmm. Carlyle versus Carbolic Smokeball Company. Not that difficult. But take, for example, this one. It's a big name, right? Pharmaceutical Society of Great Britain versus Boots Cash Chemist Limited. It's a long name. Fine if you cannot remember the entire name. But if you remember the... Take, for example, you remember what happened, the situation you remember, the judgment you remember, and also you remember it's relating to invitation to offer. And a question comes in exam relating to invitation to offer. What you can do is, you can write in a decided case. Okay, you don't need to write Pharmaceutical Society of Great Britain, this, that. You can just simply write in a decided case. Okay. What happened? You can write the situation that there were, you know, like drugs displayed with price tag. One person wanted to buy, shopkeeper refused, this, that. You can accordingly write it, okay? Not like because you don't remember it, you don't, you cannot write it. You can just simply write in a decided case. That's all, okay? But don't just apply it for every single case, because some cases are really important. You have to remember, all right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, now conditions of valid offer. So there are basically some conditions to make the offer valid. Okay, when I'm making the offer, some conditions will have to be satisfied so that this offer amounts to a valid offer. What are these conditions? First of all, offer must intend to create legal relation. That means it has to be something where we both would be legally bound, right? Making an offer, are you interested to have dinner with me tomorrow? That's not a valid offer, right? Because that will not amount to legal relation. So it's as simple as that. It will have to create legal obligation or relation. Terms of the offer must be certain, definite, and not vague. When I'm making the offer, it has to be very much clear and certain, right? I cannot say that, okay, fine, I can help you with some subjects of your first semester. I cannot say like that. What do we mean? I mean by some subjects. I will have to be specific. I will help you with contracts, right? I will have to be specific. And it should be definite. I should also mention that I'll help you and within 5 days I will complete, right? That is definite. I cannot just say that I will help you with some subjects of first semester whenever I feel like. That is very vague, right? I am not saying when I will help, what help I will do with what subject. So it has to be very clear and it has to be definite for it to be a valid offer. The offer and same, right? If I want to sell my two-wheeler, I cannot just say that I can sell you my two-wheeler for a good amount. What is good amount? I will have to tell that I want to sell my two-wheeler for 40,000 rupees. As simple as that, right? So it has to be certain and definite and not vague.
Yes.
Next is, the offer must be distinguished from a mere declaration of intention. So what is the difference between offer and declaration of intention? Take, for example, I'm just saying that I wish I got someone to buy my two-wheeler. That is declaration of intention. I'm just letting you know about my intention that I want someone to buy my two-wheeler, but that is not offer, right? So offer is different from declaration of intention. When I'm saying, are you interested in buying my two-wheeler for 40,000 rupees? That's an offer. But when I'm saying I wish someone bought my two-wheeler for 40,000 rupees, that's just declaration of intention. Even if you say that, yeah, I only can buy it for 40,000 rupees, I am not bound to sell it. Why? Because I wasn't giving you an offer. I was just declaring my intentions. Clear, right?
Yes.
Next is offer must be distinguished from an invitation to offer. This we already know, right? What is invitation to offer? An offer. So it has to be an offer, not invitation to offer. The offer must be communicated. So when I want to make an offer, I will have to communicate it so that I can, you know, like obtain your approval, right? I cannot just be thinking it on my mind and then think that you will somehow come to know about it and then you will, you know, like give your approval or something like that, right? Communication has to be there. You will have to come to know about it. Just like what the definition says, right? That it has to be communicated. So same thing. Only then it will be a valid offer. Next one, offer should not contain a term the non-compliance of which would amount to acceptance. For any offer, right? Acceptance has to be like a free acceptance, right? Freely the person should agree to it.
Yes.
So in the offer, I cannot put a condition and say that if you fail to fulfill this condition, I will consider as if you have accepted my offer. All right, I cannot do that. Take for example, I am writing an email to you and asking you, are you interested to buy my two-wheeler for 40,000 rupees? If you fail to reply to this email within 1 hour, I would consider that you have accepted my proposal. All right? I cannot do that. I cannot say that if you fail to reply within 1 hour, I would consider that you have accepted. I cannot just consider. You will have to give your acceptance.
Yes.
Right. So in the offer, I cannot put a condition and say that if you fail to fulfill this condition, it will lead to acceptance. You will have to give your proper acceptance. I cannot just say that.
Yes.
Clear, right? This point.
Yes. Yes.
Next is special terms and conditions in an offer must also be communicated. All right. So if there are some special terms and conditions, those terms and conditions must be communicated to the person. Okay, so what is special terms and conditions? Take for example, you are interested to buy something from Amazon, all right? You want to buy a dress from Amazon. Usually what you will feel is that whatever price is written there, right? If it is written 5,000 rupees, if it's written 1,000 rupees, whatever, you will consider that I will have to pay 1,000 rupees if I'm buying this dress because that is the amount that is displayed, right?
Yes.
So that is the usual term. But what is special term? After the amount, right, 1,000 rupees, they will mention plus 100 rupees delivery charge. So that is a special condition. That, yes, price for this dress is 1,000 rupees only, but you will have to pay 100 rupees as delivery charge. That is a special condition. Below that, you will see, okay, it's 15 days returnable or replaceable. That is a special condition, right?
Yes.
Then they may say that for this item, return is not accepted. Something, right? Those are special condition which will have to be displayed. So when you are opening that, you know, like that dress, you will see all the options that within 5 days, it will be delivered. You know, like delivery is free or delivery is chargeable, this, that, whatever other things are there, those are special conditions which are again clearly displayed there.
Yes.
Right. So those special terms and conditions also have to be communicated. They just cannot say that, you know, like you bought the dress thinking it's 100,000 rupees, then at the time of delivery, they cannot say that now pay 100 rupees as delivery charge. Right? Because that was not disclosed to you. That was not communicated to you. So it has to be communicated.
Yes.
Is this part clear regarding offer or proposal? Any doubts?
Yes. No, no.
Okay. So offer and acceptance are included in the same, okay, like regarding elements. So when an offer is made, again, along with that, we need acceptance as well, right? Only when acceptance is there, it will lead to a promise. So what is acceptance or promises defined under section 2B of the Indian Contract Act? All right. When the person to whom proposal is made, that means I was making the offer, right? I was making the offer to you. That means when you, right? When the person to whom proposal is made, that means you, signifies his assent thereto. That means you accept that particular offer. I made an offer to you and you give your acceptance to that. The proposal is said to be accepted. When I make an offer to you and you give your acceptance to it, we will say that my offer has been accepted by you. All right, that is what acceptance is. And a proposal when accepted becomes a promise. I gave you a proposal, you accepted it, then it becomes a promise between you and me.
Okay.
Is it clear?
Yes. Signifies his assent means gives his willingness, no?
Gives his approval. Assent as in acceptance, right? Approval. Signifies as in letting the person know, basically. So A gave an offer, B will give his acceptance. When acceptance is given, it will become a promise between the two persons.
Yes.
Now there are certain rules with regard to valid acceptance. Okay, what are these rules? First of all, acceptance must be absolute and unqualified. If you are saying, if I'm saying I want to teach Indian Contract Act within 5 days, you will have to agree to it absolutely without any conditions. You cannot say that, no, I want you to complete it within 3 days. You cannot say that, right? It has to be absolute and unqualified. That means without any conditions. Right, you have to accept it completely without any conditions. That is the first one. Second is, acceptance must be in the prescribed manner. Take for example, I can say that I want to teach you Indian Contract Act. If you are interested, just reply to me on WhatsApp. That means I have told you how you can give your acceptance. So it has to be in that way only. You cannot call me and say that I'm interested. Why? Because I have already specified how you can give your acceptance. Right? So acceptance has to be in the prescribed manner. If I'm saying you need to reply me on WhatsApp, you need to do that. If I'm saying you need to send me a letter, you need to do that. Right? Acceptance has to be in the prescribed manner. Okay, but what happens if I have not prescribed any manner? If I have not said how you need to give your acceptance, what happens in that case?
I may convey you to whichever means I'm comfortable.
So can you just send me a picture that somehow in your mind indicates you are accepting my proposal and send that to me?
No, there must be proper communication.
Yes, so it can be in any reasonable mode that people usually use, all right? So maybe you can call me, you can send me a WhatsApp message, you can send me one SMS, email, or any other thing which is common, right? Which is commonly used. But you cannot make a modern painting that somehow, in your opinion, means, you know, like communication, and then feel like, you know, like you have accepted to it. You cannot do that, right? Why you cannot do that is because that will not amount to acceptance, right? Because I will not have any option of knowing, right, that you are giving your acceptance, because that is like a modern painting which for you means acceptance, but for me it may not have any meaning, right? So it has to be in some usual or reasonable mode that is there, all right? So that is what the next point is. Okay, next is, only authorized person should communicate about the acceptance.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yeah. All right. So next one is, only authorized person should communicate about the acceptance. So what is authorized person?
Whoever is entitled to that offer.
Yeah, whoever is entitled to that offer, right? If I'm giving an offer to you, you are the one who can accept it, right? Your friend cannot accept it because I'm not making that offer to your friend, right? So accordingly, authorized person means you can approve it, or maybe if there is some agent of yours, that agent can also approve it. If you have some, you know, like some other persons, right? If it's a partnership firm, maybe all any of the partners can accept. Basically, someone should have the authority to accept it on behalf of someone else, right? It cannot be some random person who is giving. Right, if I'm making an offer, some random person from the road cannot come and give acceptance. Right, it has to be by someone who is an authorized person.
Yes.
All right. Next is acceptance should be made within the time prescribed or within a reasonable time. What is that?
With permanency or time given for offer, like if it is invitation to offer, then the acceptance of that person will go if the time limit goes or the seats go.
Okay, so it has to be within the time prescribed or within a reasonable time. If I am take for example, if you are saying that okay, fine, my exams are nearing, it will be maybe from 17th of March, I want help for contracts. In that case, you are specifying, right, that from 17th your exams might start. I cannot give you an offer and say that okay, fine, you know, like after 18th we will start, right? That should not be the case. So it has to be within the time prescribed if time is given, or within a reasonable time. What is reasonable? It depends on the time, right? If you are saying regarding your exams, what is reasonable? Before 17th it should be started. That is reasonable. Or I may say that I want to, you know, like sell my two-wheeler. And if you want to buy it, just give your approval within 1 week. I cannot just wait beyond 1 week. In that case, time is prescribed, right? I'm saying that 1 week is the time that you have. Within that, if you want, you give your approval. Otherwise, time over, right? So if I'm prescribing a time, it has to be within that time. If not, it has to be within a reasonable time. All right? But what is reasonable, that we cannot just define, because it will depend on the situation, right? If I take, for example, I just want to, you know, like buy a medicine from a shop, the reasonable time may be just few minutes, right? If I'm going to a medical store and asking whether they have a certain medicine or not, they cannot take like 1 month or 1 day to tell me, right? I want the answer immediately, within 2-3 minutes maybe. Right. But in another case, if I'm saying that next month I have a family function, for that I want a marriage hall, do you have your hall available? Maybe they can take some 1 week time also. Right. So it depends what is reasonable time. It may be few seconds, few minutes, hours, days, months, and even years in some cases. Right. So what is reasonable? It will depend. If time is fixed, within that time, if not, within a reasonable time. All right, is that clear?
Yes.
Okay, so next is acceptance should be given before the offer lapses or is withdrawn. What is that? Before the
Before the offer gets over, you should give your acceptance. Otherwise, after the offer gets over, there is no use of your acceptance.
Yeah, so it has to be before the offer lapses or is withdrawn. Withdrawn as in I'm taking back my offer. Okay, I went to you and said, are you interested in buying my two-wheeler for 40,000? You did not reply for 1 week. And then I said, oh no, I got someone already. So don't worry, okay? You don't need to give your acceptance. That means I have withdrawn my offer, right? I already got someone. So now your acceptance is not needed. So before I withdraw my offer, you should give your acceptance, or before the offer lapses. If I'm saying that I want to sell my two-wheeler, you have 1 week's time to give your acceptance. After 1 week, the offer will lapse, right? After 1 week, you don't have any more time to give your acceptance. So before that one offer lapses or is withdrawn, you should give your acceptance.
Yes.
Is it clear? Rules of valid acceptance. Any points you have doubt?
No.
Okay, so there is one case, Feldhaus versus Bindley. So this is relating to formation of valid contract.
Okay.
Okay, so for formation of valid contract, acceptance must be communicated. Okay, so this is regarding communication of acceptance. What happened in this case basically is that Okay, so there were three people. All right, so there were three people. One was plaintiff, one was nephew of the plaintiff, and another person was employee who helped in conducting certain auctions.
Okay.
So in this case, what happened? There was one nephew and another uncle and one employee. So uncle wanted to buy. So nephew was having like many horses, all right? And he was conducting an auction to sell his horses.
Okay.
And he was also having an employee who was helping him with all the arrangements and everything for the auction. Now he conducted the auction and there was one uncle who came there and he wanted to buy one horse from there.
Hmm.
All right. But he was negotiating with regard to the price. So basically he wanted to pay a lesser amount and the nephew wanted a higher amount. So it was like in negotiation stage only. All right.
Yeah.
So later what happened is that uncle sent a letter to the nephew and he said that if I hear no more about him, I consider the horse to be mine at 30.15 euros. That means $30.15. That means he sent a letter and said that if you do not reply to this or if you do not object this price, then I would consider that you are selling this horse to me for $30.15. All right. So nephew did not reply to this letter because he was very busy with the auction, right? Ongoing auction. But he accepted that, okay, fine, I will give the horse to my uncle for this price only. Okay. So what he did is that he told his employee that do not sell this horse because I will be giving this to my uncle for $30.15, whatever. I will be giving this to my uncle. So don't send, sell this.
Uh-huh.
He gave an instruction to the employee, but he did not reply to the uncle. All right.
Okay.
But this employee, by mistake, he sold the horse to someone else.
Okay.
Okay. Then what happened? This uncle filed a case, okay, regarding this auction that it was not sold to him and all that stuff. But now what was held in this case? Although the nephew intended the uncle to have the horse, but although the nephew wanted that he will be selling the horse to his uncle for the price that uncle has mentioned, he had done nothing to communicate the intention, right? He did not reply to the letter or he did not do anything, right? So he is not bound because he have not accepted that particular offer, right? Acceptance he has not given. Also, the offer should not contain a clause non-compliance of which would amount to its acceptance. Uncle cannot just write that if you do not reply to this letter, I would consider that you have accepted this price for this horse, right? Because acceptance has to come properly from the other person. So in this case, it was held that there is no contract between the parties and the person is not bound to pay compensation to the uncle. Why? Because there was no communication of acceptance, right? Even though in his mind, nephew was thinking that I will be selling my horse to the uncle, he did not tell it properly, right? There was no communication, right? So he is not bound under it. Is this case clear?
Yes, yes.
Okay. So next, another case is there. Pauli versus Lee. This is relating to acceptance of an offer must be communicated to the offerer by offeree himself or by an authorized agent. So as we have seen, right, in the conditions of valid acceptance, acceptance has to be by the same person or some authorized person who is having authority, right? It cannot be any random person who just comes and gives acceptance on someone else's behalf. So this case is relating to that only. So what happened in this case basically is that there was a school, okay, and that school had a vacancy for the post of headmaster.
Okay,
then there was a managing committee of the school. That means there were few members who were part of this managing committee and they were about to select a person for this post of headmaster. All right, then one person appeared for the interview for headmaster and there were like many people who appeared for the interview basically.
Okay.
And amongst all of those, candidates, one person, one of the candidates, right? He knew one person from this managing committee. Like both of them were friends, all right? They knew each other. Okay, so after the interview was done, the managing committee thought that, okay, fine, we will be selecting this particular candidate only as headmaster. The person who knew one from the managing committee, right? That person who was friends with someone with from the managing committee, that person was like roughly selected that, fine, maybe we are selecting this person only. From the managing committee, right, this person who was friends with this candidate, right, he came to the friend and told him that managing committee has selected you as the headmaster. All right, but at a later stage, after all the evaluation, this, that, managing committee changed their decision. They decided that we are not selecting this person, but rather we will be selecting this other person as headmaster. Okay, and that was published. So this candidate who was informed, right, he filed a case that how come you know, like, changed your decision, you decided to select me as headmaster, how come you are selecting another person? He filed a case in the court.
Yes.
Right. So court said that it was not communicated to you, right? Even though whoever told you was a member of managing committee, he told you just because he was a friend of yours. He was not given that authority by the management, right? Because that decision was not yet finalized when it was disclosed to you. So that is not proper acceptance, and managing committee is not bound to select you. Why? Because whatever was disclosed, that was not proper communication. Your friend was not having authority to disclose that to you. The decision was not yet finalized. That time only it was disclosed, right? So in this case, it was said that it has to be properly communicated by someone who is authorized, and only then it will be valid, right? In a person's personal capacity, just because he is friends with a candidate, he cannot say, and that will not be binding on the managing committee.
Yes.
Is it clear, this case?
Yes.
Okay, any doubts from this part?
No.
All right. So these are the basic elements that we have: offer plus acceptance, intention to create legal relationship or consideration, capacity of parties, free consent, and lastly, lawful consideration and object. So we have completed the first one, which is offer plus its acceptance, right? Valid offer plus valid acceptance.
Yes.
Okay, so this part is clear, right? Whatever we discussed today?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so next we will discuss what is intention to create legal relationship and some cases from there as well. So for today, we saw difference between offer and agreement, contract and agreement, and what is offer. Offer should reflect expression of readiness. It should be made to another person to obtain the other person's consent or approval. It can be expressed also, it can be implied also. Implied from my behavior or from my actions, right? And to whom offer is made. Even when you go to a shop, right, you may just indicate what you want to buy, right? Sometimes you may just go to a shop and maybe you want to buy a cigarette, you can just show like this. You want to buy a cup of tea, you can just show like this, right? The other person would understand what you want to buy and he can accordingly give. You don't need to ask that, okay, fine, give me a cup of coffee or give me a cigarette or something like that, right? Sometimes your actions or behavior also reflect, and accordingly the contract may take place, right?
Yes.
Okay, so these were some of the cases which we discussed. So fine, then you can go through this part. If any doubts or anything you have, then
yes,
we can discuss that. Okay, you can see the screen, right? Like a different
page.
Yeah, so these were some of the questions, like all contracts are agreements, but all agreements are not contracts. Explain. Explain offer and acceptance. Can they be revoked? Revocation we will study. So you can just, when it's like explain offer and acceptance, you can just define in your own words, whatever essentials, elements, whatsoever you know, accordingly you can just write, right? Because they have not clearly specified what you need to write. Just write anything that you know regarding offer and acceptance, right? So you are free to write anything. Define proposal, explain the circumstances under which it will lapse. Define offer, explain the rules relating to valid offer with the help of decided cases. So accordingly, there are these previous year questions from previous year papers.
Yeah. Well, so under which it lapses means?
Which one? Okay, question number four. Define proposal. Explain the circumstances under which it lapses. It may lapse when the time is over, when I'm making a proposal and saying you need to give your acceptance within 2 weeks. It will lapse after 2 weeks time frame. Or I have not mentioned any time frame, after a reasonable time it will lapse, right? Or if it is withdrawn, right? In those cases, it will lapse.
Okay.
Yeah. Any other doubts or anything you have?
No.
All right. Fine then. So we'll end this class here and we'll continue with the remaining provisions. Okay. By that time, you can just go through this part. Any doubts, any questions, you can always come back. All right.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay then. Fine. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Yeah. Bye-bye.
Bye.